Isn't it funny, Scott, how there are some things in life that get easier the more and more you do them, but conversely, there are things that the more and more you do them, the more difficult it seems, or the more dust you can see in the corners. I see podcasting as one of those things. It's like every week, where this is Opus 149, we're getting up close to the end of season three. I remember in those early opuses, the concept of turning on mics and just having a conversation seemed so easy. It seemed like something that we didn't have the opportunity to do as creators very often, especially considering the way that we prep for radio and especially public radio, classical radio, all of that. So it was like, okay, well, no problem. We're going to cut on the mics and just have a conversation. Coming back week after week, it's like, okay, how do I one up myself? How do I, continue the momentum? It's difficult. How do you deal? What do you give yourself a pep talk on your drive over here every week? What do you do?
Shit.
Have some rock music going on in the car to
Usually in the mornings, that's when I do my listening, and reading of stuff, and I try to avoid other tech. And so that's my time. And on the way over here, I don't know. I'm just quiet. On Mondays I can go all day and not say a word.
So you save all of your words for Trilloquy. I
See how my
appreciate
voice is still warming up?
it. Well, we'll get you warmed up today. When I think about the way that things used to be when it comes to Trilloquy, it makes me think about the way things used to be when it comes to advocating for renewing certain spaces within Western classical music. I began all of my, troublemaking in public radio down in Tennessee. Shout out to WUOT. And the first composer that I was really trying to cram down people's throats, so to speak, while I, every show of mine had somebody black. And some women can, so that was always a part of my thing. But the composer that I wanted to really normalize for that audience in particular was Philip Glass. Do you have any ideas on Philip Glass as far as his level of appropriateness now versus when you were first getting started in classical radio? These days, it's not so radical to put on some Philip Glass, but maybe, 25, 30 years ago, it was a different story.
I don't remember those things coming across my playlist hardly at all. So, a lot of people, this is shocking stuff for some reason, or it's too much, too fast. And other people are like, wow, more of this, please. Let's go.
And just so that, people know what we're talking about. One of the pieces by Philip Glass that I'm always paying attention to and returning to, it's his first violin concerto. This is the opening of his of the third movement of his first violin concerto. And in this music, you can just feel some tenseness. It feels like something is about to happen. And what's about to happen is a violin soloist up at the front of the orchestra bodying the bariolage, bodying the technique. Let's listen here. Ridiculous to think that music that sounds like that aesthetic had to be fought for and not all that long ago. I had a lot of and everyone is, entitled to their own taste in music, that's fine. But one of the biggest critiques that I would get when I would program Glass is that, oh, well, I understand that young people like you like all of that fast sounding music,
Crunchy stuff.
but we're just trying to find something to relax to. And, that's not appropriate for this and that and whatever. So as much as, we have conversations of racial equity and gender equity and how those things can renew classical spaces, it's important to remember that. Some of these, and I almost hate saying it here on this platform, but some of these white men got a hard row too. Their music not being accepted and put into the space. You can tell it's time for our between season break because I'm here in the opening of Trilloquy giving it up for somebody of a paler hue. So to class solidarity, I suppose. Hello, everybody. Hey. This is Opus 149, the penultimate opus of Trilloquy for season 3. And we're going to get going this week with a downbeat from Van Lathan. For folks who don't know, Van Lathan was formerly with TMZ. He was in the middle of a huge media firestorm when he was fired on some racial stuff. If you want to backtrack and look at that, I'll have a link in the description. But I watched an interview that he did earlier today, and he hit on something, Scott, that I want us to talk about before we get into the topics that we have to talk about today. Let's take a listen.
It's weird to have the conversation about why blackface is wrong for the 100th time.
Right up.
Like, you're like, yo, wait, are you stupid or am I?
Right
up. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, who like, and all of these things over and over again, waking up, watching brothers and sisters killed all the time, you can't help but be crazy. Some of these social justice people that you know, that like, that you guys see, I know them, they are not terribly well-adjusted people. It's just hard to be.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard to be a terribly well-adjusted person when you are fighting for something that's right, but you are constantly assailed.
Right.
All the time, from every single side.
So you do you see how that part of the conversation, what he was saying, reminds me of our work?
Mm-hmm.
Let's put, just for right now, conversations of race and gender to the side. We were just talking about Philip Glass and making space for his music that does not sound like Beethoven, Mozart, and him, but making equal space for it in these classical spaces. When you hear music like that and it really engages with your spirit and your musical sensibilities and what you want audiences to hear, and folks are just sending you emails about how this is trash, this is noisy, oh, what are you doing? It's hard to stay well-balanced. That's what Van Lathan was saying there, you know? So there's that. But then when you have someone like me, you know, a black man who is trying to do what I can to make sure that historic black composers, much less the black composers today, have equal footing, who a lot of times music is not as crunchy, as they say, as some of these other contemporary composers like Philip Glass, when I have to deal with that,
mm-hmm.
that just intensifies it and really makes you just feel crazy. Or what am I doing? Or should I have a job where I don't have to deal with these sorts of things? I wonder if you can speak to the challenge of remaining well-adjusted in the change-making work that we do, the change-making work that you do.
I don't know, because I don't know if I'm necessarily the best subject to ask about that sort of thing. I don't feel particularly well-adjusted right now.
Yeah.
But, you know, who was it that said to keep doing things over and over and expecting something different?
Right.
That's the definition.
Yeah, I think they say that's the Einstein quote. I've heard that,
or
that's
Franklin,
been misappropriate,
yeah.
But anyway.
Okay,
yeah.
So Abraham Franklin said,
right.
said
right.
this.
Right.
And yeah, I how many more times, it's like when you have a Haydn symphony that comes up over and over and over.
Ciao. And they all sound the same if we're really going to say something about it.
Now, I'm saying is that how many times are you going to tell the same story?
Yes. Yeah.
So if you can, you know, if you can add something new, I mean, to me, Philip Glass is old school.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
You know?
Much less the Rite of Spring,
right.
and all of the Alban Berg compositions that are 100 years old or more now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you talk about repeating the same old stories, having dealt with that in Western classical spaces, I feel like plays a role in how I try to keep from doing that in other ways, despite the fact that I may need to, for the sake of equity. Shout out to Caesar, you know, my mentor in many ways, and Buddhism and music. We were on the line today. I had a meeting with him, and you know, he has a weekly program, a weekly Zoom live lecture series that he does, and you know, folks donate, and you know, it's really incredible what he's built for himself. But every other time I have a meeting with him, he says, "Garrett, I hate to tell you, and I know that you won't believe me, but no one has heard of Florence Price." And that sounds ridiculous
mm-hmm.
to me, especially considering the fact that we say her name and William Grant Still's name so much that we try to point folks to other black composers, the Nathaniel Detts and the Margaret Bonds, as not to repeat the name Florence Price and William Grant Still too much. And even so, it's still people who somehow just have not heard of them. In the second movement today, I'm going to talk about William Grant Still and a piece of music that I'm actually performing in real life coming up this week. But one of the collaborators had not heard of William Grant Still. What are your thoughts on balancing not beating the horse as we did with Beethoven versus the fact that as much as it feels like we're saying those names, William Grant Still, Florence Price, is still more repetition that we need to do for the sake of the folks who still have not heard of it?
Yeah, there's a saying that the first program director I worked with had was, somebody is discovering this for the first time every time. And that is so hard. That is so hard to keep in mind, because when you see something that you've talked about come up over and over and you go, all right, let me see let me see how we can dress this up. I will say that there has been improvements.
I mean, people are familiar with those names, certainly more than they were 10 years ago, much less 20 years ago.
And I also, think
there's still more room to go.
And I also think that there are people that are more open-minded to this sort of thing than they realize.
Yeah.
Because of what they've, the only thing that they've had created an expectation of a certain experience. So I know that there are people out there that are hungry about it. And another thing that I try to do to keep myself centered is remember that only the, usually it's the people with the most extreme opinions are sounding off loudest.
Okay.
Right? No, but I mean, when you get a salty email or something like that, you know, there's a lot of people in there that I'm sure the things that you say and do are resonating with, but they don't, feel like they need to write to you and say one way or the other.
And I think about that all the time, especially when you're going through some of those not so great comment threads and emails. I'll probably speak to some of that here a little later this opus. But before we jump in, I wanted to, you know, again, circle back to what Van Lathan was saying about not being well balanced. Later on in the interview, he talks about identifying co-conspirators, identifying accomplices as one of those means of just keeping your mind together and not feeling like you're totally crazy. How do you deal with the question of, well, what can I do? Or what is the best thing for me to contribute to this sort of work of DEI? Like, how do you address that if it comes your way, when it comes your way?
Sure. Well, the first thing is to help that person out and say, it is not the responsibility of the person that you're asking to find out what you need to do. You need to go and find your blind spots and do that work.
Right.
So that's the first thing that you would say. But as far as recognizing when other people are doing it, I mean, you really got to be looking, because the people who are really doing this kind of work well aren't broadcasting all this pat me on the back stuff, you know, that sort of a thing.
And while I sigh because, and we've talked about this on Trilloquy, I understand and recognize that so much of the work happens behind the scenes, and there can sometimes be schisms between folks who have very front-facing work and say, oh, well, I'm the only one out here doing X, Y, and Z, and then other people are like, well, I'm behind the scenes doing these things. I acknowledge and honor all of the behind-the-scenes work that happens, and I acknowledge that front-facing work requires, unfortunately, front-facing critique and front-facing, you know, pushback. And again, it's not like this is some spatial sort of abstract concept that we're trying to put into the world. There are actual values and actual individuals that are connected with the battle of renewing classical spaces. So before we jump in this week, I just wanted to offer everybody that's something that they can do. Yes, Scott, I agree with you that it's not the onus of marginalized people to figure out the roadmap for folks in positions of power. And there are initiatives happening where folks can join folks who are doing the work that we do here and helping to renew these spaces. I'm going to quickly read today. It was announced the formation of the Black Orchestral Network on the front page of their website. You'll read that the Black Orchestral Network started with a theory. It says, if we increase our connection to one another, we can harness our creativity and develop initiatives that benefit Black musicians. The founders of the Black Orchestral Network are Jen Arnold with the Richmond Symphony, member of the Trilloquy family, Alex Lang, who will be coming on Trilloquy, not today, but next week, along with Jen, to talk a bit about the Black Orchestral Network. We have David Norville, who's been on Trilloquy.
Oh, yeah.
And let me give a special dramatic boom to David Norville, because when he said, oh, classical spaces are the last vestiges of white supremacy and y'all don't want to talk about it, that's when I felt like Trilloquy was going in the right direction. Mm. That was early in season one. So shout out to Dave Norville. Among the other founders are Joy Payton Stevens, a cellist down in the Seattle area. We have Shay Scruggs, legendary oboe player who now works in philanthropy and those spaces. Weston Sprott, trombonist with the Met Orchestra, with the Metropolitan Opera Orchestra, and of course Titus Underwood, who we all know and love. So this is a star-studded array of change makers who are not only out here preaching and yelling and screaming into the ether, but folks who have put something together for everyone to jump onto to force the orchestral industry to do what it needs to do to really diversify its stage toward diversifying its audiences. So you can join the cause by being a signatory to their letter. You can read the letter and learn more about each of the founders at blackorchestralnetwork.org. When we started this show, Scott, when we started Trilloquy, it didn't seem to be that many people who understood the problem, much less people who understood how to approach the problem, how to form things to get us talking about how we're going to change it. Now, you know, here in 2022, there are more and more grassroots organizations and even more individuals fighting this good fight. We have chosen, Scott, you know, no matter what happens at this point, we have chosen what side of this battle, of this conversation we're on. Mm-hmm. You listening right now, it's time for you to make that step up choice, that definitive choice. Help us be a part of this push and continue to listen to hear us talk about more of this push. Let's get into it.
I'm Scott Blankenship.
And this is Trilloquy, Opus 149. Scott, speaking of that push.
That's crazy.
That push for change. I wonder if you can just quickly think of an example of what you are comfortable saying here on Opus 149 that maybe you wouldn't have been comfortable saying or admitting or shining a light on in Opus 9 or Opus 49. I feel like there have to be, you know, again, as I was speaking to, more and more people are joining the cause of seeing a problem with orchestral spaces, number one, and then working to renew them. Maybe naming the problem is something that is completely normal now, or more normal for you now than it was at the very beginning.
It's all about audience as to what I feel comfortable saying, where I have to think about who I'm delivering it to, right?
Yeah.
And the way that I communicate here is very different than the way that I communicate at my job.
Right.
But there are aspects of both in each.
Yeah.
And I'm taking darts from both sides.
Oh, yeah. I hear you.
Yeah. So with me accepting the fact that that's just going to happen, there's a little bit of freedom that comes with that.
Yeah.
If you walk into that room like, all right, well, someone's going to get irritated. Let's see who it is.
You know, and that freedom, I feel like, makes the work more genuine. There are fewer concessions that are being made with that freedom when it comes to what one will talk about.
Or... Yeah, there was a recently during a shift, someone was sitting in and having a chat, and I did a quick break that was a little bit spicy. I turned off the microphone and I turned around and I said, "And now we wait."
Do you remember what the break was or what you were talking about?
Yeah, I was saying that folks should not refer to somebody as the blah blah Mozart.
Van Lathan just said, how many times are we going to say blackface is wrong? You are still up there on the radio station telling these people don't say the black Mozart? Damn.
So it was actually the black Mahler, but okay.
Oh, cool. Samuel Coleridge Taylor. Right.
So it was a different break.
they will find somebody to compare us to every time. The black Mozart, the black Mahler.
And that's really the, that was, you know, so, it was so gentle.
They love to call Florence Price the black Dvorak without saying it, you know.
Oh, God. Yeah. And it was a very gentle, like, you know, I don't think that's cool. Don't do that.
Here's some Samuel Coleridge Taylor. Shout out to you, Scott.
1 minute, 15 seconds.
You got some email?
Ping. You've got mail.
Oh, my gosh. Ooh. The laughs from the work keep me from just completely tearing my head off and throwing it in the trash can. Hello, everybody. Thank you for returning. To new listeners, this is a podcast. Trilloquy is a podcast that takes the phrase classical music and contextualizes it to include more music, more conversation, and everything in between. You can check out past opuses and contribute to the Trilloquy podcast at trilloquy.org. In addition to your support, Trilloquy is made possible in part by Springboard for the Arts, a local arts institution making sure that artists have a means of making a living and a life. More on them at springboardforthearts.org. I want to send a thank you to the Lakeville Area Arts Center. I'll be performing some Samuel Coleridge Taylor, speaking of the so-called Black Mozart, and some William Grant Still. I'll talk a little bit more about that in the second movement, but I want to send a thanks to them. If you're in the Minnesota area and you want to, you know, you're used to hearing me talk and talk shit, if you want to hear me actually play the bassoon, you know, what I'm supposed to be doing, if the ecosystem wasn't so ghetto out here, if you want to hear me play, I'll have information in the description. And I also want to send a thank you of support to the Hennepin County Library. The Hennepin County Library is in the middle of what they call men spin right now, Scott. Mm. That's when folks offer their recordings, their self-made recordings of music. And there are curators who go in and select a number of those to be included in the library system so that folks can go listen to local music, classical music, so-called and otherwise, right there at the library. So shout out to Hennepin County Library. I'll have more information on Men Spin in the description of this as well. A few things to talk about this week, I think. Scott, what do you have to say? So let's go ahead and jump in. This is Movement 1. You have an accidental that you brought in, and I'll go ahead and give it a sharp. You said this one is going to get a sharp. Mm-hmm. But the headline, Scott, is a question that I feel like I've been just directly asking on this podcast for the past at least couple weeks. Mm-hmm. Can classical music be inclusive? Not we need to make it inclusive, mm-hmm. but can it be? Before we get into this article by Tom Huizinga, what is your answer to that question? Just the plain answer to the question, can classical music really be inclusive?
In my positive frame of mind, I say of course, and I have to be optimistic, and I tell myself that I can be part of that. I don't necessarily have to lead it. I can be part of it.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's times when you ask me what you asked me just a few moments ago.
And then
ago,
there's times when you're at work playing Boccherini.
And I haven't had Boccherini for a while. But anyway. the point being that it depends on when you ask me.
Sure.
But I'm doing everything I can every day to keep the positive. I have to,
yeah,
because like I said before, if I don't, I fall into despair.
Well, when they asked Jessie Montgomery, she said that she believes classical music can be inclusive.
Right. That was the following of it. The rest of the title, Jessie Montgomery thinks so. And a few months ago, I brought in an article that you might remember the headline was "The Changing American Canon Sounds Like Jessie Montgomery."
Mm-hmm.
And we talked about, well, wait, does she want that mantle? Does she want that sort of spotlight?
Yeah.
Okay, so she answered it here. The answer was she is in an exceptional position, not only as a composer whose works are suddenly skyrocketing in demand, but one who feels responsibility to help lead the field face sharper questions of diversity and inclusion. While the brighter spotlight comes with pressure, she relishes the opportunity to help reframe American music and the institutions that present it. I take that as a little bump of inspiration.
Yeah. And with great privilege comes great responsibility. For anyone, you know, we talk about folks still don't know the name Florence Price. Mm-hmm. So for folks who still don't know the name Jesse Montgomery, she's a black woman, a living composer. I think she's about 40 years old. I think that's what it says here in this article. You've met her in person.
Yeah.
You know, shared a little of the devil's lettuce, as it were, over in Detroit. I'm putting all her business out here. But listen, she's down. And one of the conversations that we tend to skirt, not only here on Trilloquy, but just in art spaces, is the fact that as orchestras start to commission more women composers and composers of color, it's about four or five of them that get the call all across the country. And Jesse Montgomery is at the top of that list. But with that privilege comes great responsibility. And it seems like that is not lost on her, and that she is taking that responsibility seriously.
Well, when we talk about what fires you up to continue when you see what you're up against and you get nonsense articles coming out like the one that you're going to bring in, man, I can't help but think about that responsibility.
Mm-hmm. One of the questions that Tom asked her in this written interview, I have it linked in the description, he says, it's quite possible that what presenters are afraid to offer is any brand new music. See, we were talking about that in the opening, again, with Philip Glass having to fight for him, and he's not even a black man.
Right.
But I think Jesse says something really important in response to that question. She says here, even organizations like the Sphinx Organization that I've been a part of since 1999, and they've been a tremendous supporter of my career that is committed to diversity in classical music, just this year had their first program of all black and Latinx composers. There was always this need or belief that we had to have a so-called real classical piece on there by an old traditional composer in order to legitimize the program. We all are going on a journey. And I think that's one of the key things to understand. The way that I programmed at WUOT back in 2016, it was radical, you know, but I would be doing even more now, because there are just certain things, certain aesthetics and certain conversations that have been normalized. So toward broadening that spectrum of normalization, we have to keep pushing.
Right. You'll always be the one out there on the edge. But
gladly.
Right. And see, another thing that she said gives me some hope, and that I try to apply to radio listenership. I've said before, I try to give people a little bit more space to not assume that people are going to be closed-minded to something.
Yeah.
So what she says, with any kind of programming, with any new kind of programming and endeavor, you take a leap of faith that the audience is going to be into it. She says, I find that audiences show up because they want the experience of live music or live theater, something that sparks their imagination and soothes their pain.
Yeah.
So I would take that cue, if I were in charge of programming, I would take that cue to get a little bit more adventurous, to widen the circle a little bit, engage it.
Yeah.
Give your audiences some credit.
It's interesting that you talk about that, you know, giving the audience some credit. One of the things she writes here is, or that she said here has been transcribed, as a black person, you sit down to write and you think, oh, these rhythms are going to be too, air quotes, jazzy, which is not even accurate, or too hyperrhythmic, or maybe I shouldn't put these bends in. It's going to sound too black or something. And that's unfortunately something that I have struggled with in my own thinking about my music. We talk about code switching in the way that we dress or in the way that we speak. The idea of artistic, I mean, what the fruit of your being, you know, as a composer, how you have to double think it because somebody is going to perceive those notes in a way. And again, We talked about this a while ago, the idea of, are the notes themselves racist? Well, there are cultural implications, you know, even sometimes racial implications of some of these notes, you know, just the straight up sounds that come out. And it's not lost on folks like Jesse Montgomery that there are people who will hear those things and say, oh, that's jazz. That doesn't belong here. Oh, that's bluesy. That doesn't belong here. Which when I hear that, all I hear people saying is, oh, that's black. That doesn't belong here.
I understand you.
And that's all that and that's all you have to say on that. Okay, well, thank you for that sharp shout out to Jesse Montgomery.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that some of Jesse's answers gave me some inspiration, propped me up a little bit. She talks about how really the industry is about building relationships.
Yeah.
Take that away.
Yeah.
It's about take that with you when you go. This is all about communicating. It's all about creating a relationship, a reciprocal relationship.
You know, as I think more about the fact
and legacy
that Caesar was telling me, that folks still don't know Florence Price, folks still don't know William Grant Still. I'm going to keep that in mind when it comes to Jesse Montgomery. You know, even in some of my own programming, I find myself open to the critique of, well, you know, there are more living composers out here than Jesse Montgomery. But how about, well, not but, and how about we celebrate the fact that one of our own, a black woman from New York, you know, someone who had every opportunity to not be a name that we know in classical music, you know, the fact that she has made it, that's worth celebrating. And I'm going to do a better job of pushing her music even more. Mm-hmm. You know, the composer that they were tired of me playing at WUOT was Shostakovich, because in that era of my transform the space thought, Shostakovich was a little left, you know.
Yeah.
So of course I've gone way off from that, you know, the way that I would push Philip Glass. I'm going to be pushing some more Jesse Montgomery. We talk about her piece Starburst all the time. Folks play Banner all the time. Those are some two really incredible works. But I took a listen to a tune by Jesse Montgomery today that I hadn't heard before, so I'm going to share a little bit of that here. It's a tune called Voodoo Dolls. This performance features the Lunart Festival strings. What are your first listen impressions on the aesthetic that Jesse Montgomery is putting out into the ecosystem by way of string quartet?
There was a little hint of Philip Glass. I felt some of the, you know, the twitchiness of it. That was pretty good.
I like the percussive nature at the beginning. And, you know, as a composer, I know that a lot of, in addition to thinking about how audiences are going to react, I know that composers also have to think about how musicians are going to act, because I know some of these, especially some of these cello players, they're not about to be knocking on the instrument.
you gotta say that right when I took a drink. You
gotta beg. You gotta beg some of these string players. I think it's called, y'all gonna be in my email. I think it's called dalsegno, where you take the wood of the bow and beat them. You know, they do that in the Berlioz, the Symphony Fantastique. And, you know, so I've seen a lot of musicians just with a little pencil on their stand. Anyway, shout out to those musicians for giving us what we need, you know, by offering the percussive aspect of it as well. Anyway, shout out to Lunart Strings and to Jesse Montgomery, Voodoo Dolls. I'm gonna be returning to that a lot this week.
Cool.
Yeah, because it's really cool. All right, well, one more accidental for this first movement, and it's gonna be a flat for me. And Scott, I hate to tell you, it's more from Norman LeBrecht.
Oh, we gotta read.
You know, Norman LeBrecht at this point is one of those writers, one of those critics, that people see his name and they just decide, okay, you know what? I'm not doing it. I'm not even going to click on the article. He's neither here nor there. He's gone. You know, as you might say in a way of saying,
I hate to say it. I hope I don't sound ridiculous. I don't know who this man is.
Before I jump into this article, I just wanted to acknowledge that, because I know there are folks listening to this and they're like, oh, here we go. Norman LeBrecht, she's full of shit. I don't know why y'all even give him the time of day, why you share his articles, give him the internet traffic. Can you at least see what I put you in that box of people. My argument is that's how we got Donald Trump now, you know, letting the sleeping dragon just sleep until it's too late, until he's been fed enough or has had enough rest. I don't think it would be ridiculous to one day wake up to the news headline that, you know, the Met Orchestra or somebody has hired their new executive director, acclaimed critic,
if
Norman LeBrecht.
If that happened, you know? They better announce in blackface.
You said they better announce in blackface. What do you mean?
Yes, because that is ridiculous.
Well, is it? But it's not outside the realm of possibility. You know, you yourself say that every time you cut on the TV, oh, you're not even surprised anymore by the crazy shit that be going on in the world. That could be among the crazy things that happen if we don't shine a light
the simulation.
On this narrative. I think we need as many people as possible understanding what folks like Norman LeBrecht are out here doing and saying about people of color, specifically black folks. Some of them are alive. I had to cuss him out several months back. I think he was saying something about Randall Goosby. Mm-hmm. And
sure.
And we even bleeped some stuff out of that one. Anyway, I'm in my zone now. I am fully embracing Nam-myoho Renge Kyo. So I'm not going to cuss Norman out, but we need to look at some of the things he said anyway. This article comes from thecritic.co.uk. The title, Bring On the Big Beasts. He says here, think hard. You may remember a time when a symphony orchestra was a collection of musical instruments rather than an instrument of social policy. Stop right there. I don't remember that. I remember in the early 1800s when Beethoven was using symphonies most certainly as an instrument of social policy and political thought. I can go all the way back to how political it was, if we're centering Western Europe, for someone like Hildegard von Bingen to be out here writing the stuff that she wrote in that style as a woman. So, you know, it has always been that. Speaking again of these things that we keep saying over and over and over again, policy, politics, social thought, and music being one in the same is not new. This is not new, and we're still doing that
to this day.
Your ideas, your thoughts, just on that opening. People who refuse to see orchestral music as something that does in fact have an impact on the world.
Sure. You talked about Shostakovich, you know, there was...
He was out here in real trouble with the real law.
Prokofiev ended up in exile. Rachmaninoff couldn't get back home for, what, 2 decades?
Mm-hmm.
Something like that.
Yeah.
1899, Jean Sibelius writes Finlandia. So I'm just going to go back to the Norman thing that I've seen this show. And so...
And
as I glance through it, okay, we have the, okay, left hand, let's have some,
backhanded compliment.
Yeah, let's hear a couple backhanded compliments. This is almost okay in a adagietto Mahler-esque sort of kind of way, but it doesn't, you know, all the ingredients are there from the show that I have already seen.
What he is circling in a number of examples is the fact that he doesn't think it's fair that we're sidelining the so-called true masters because of the political correctness and the social justice activist aspect of programming. Let me read one of the statements here. He writes, the National Symphony Orchestra of Washington, D.C. is putting on a cycle of Beethoven symphonies paired with works by George Walker and William Grant Still. Both were blanked in their lifetimes because of their skin color, and both deserve a fair hearing. But to bracket them with Beethoven as so-called American masters is like speed dating James Galway with a penny whistler. So he doesn't like the idea that these black composers have any proximity in the way that we honor them to the one and only great Beethoven. How are you going to tell me that this man is just not straight up racist? See, moving ahead in the arts, we talk about transforming these spaces. The thing that we also need to let into the space and normalize in the space is really speaking to racism, capital R racism, when we see it. That's what I get
from that.
One
of the bylines, meek white Finns who apologize for their whiteness and maleness. I don't even know what to do with it, man. I don't. Why are you laughing?
Okay, no, okay.
What's
no,
funny?
No. When he talks about the beast, what he's getting at is someone who will finally just stand up.
I understand
for classical music. You know, he misappropriates Florence Price as someone from Kentucky. She was from Arkansas, for the record. But what I put on my social media, what I quoted as soon as I saw this a few days ago, is what it says here. He says, hypocrisy abounds in this debate. I have campaigned as loud and long as Marin Alsup for an even playing field, but I would never consent to the designation of George Walker as a deathless American master. What is needed right now is a music director with the balls. He said that. Can you believe that? With the balls, in a non-gender sense, to resist the reformist trolls. A J.K. Rowling who will stand up for truth. A conductor who can put the music first. Mm-hmm. He is really standing out here on a ledge, because if you don't know the way that they canceled J.K. Rowling out here, you've been sleeping under a rock or don't pay attention to Harry Potter. But this is someone, Norman LeBrecht, someone who really wants a, dare I say, Donald Trump type figure, this great white knight, if I may, to come onto the podium and say, enough with the identity politics, enough with all of this DEI nonsense. Let's get back to orchestral concerts as they should be. Mm. It's frustrating to see. But what's more frustrating, Scott, really the point I want to make in bringing this in, I'll let y'all read everything that he has to say. But I believe that we are complicit in some of these actions and thoughts when we put forward the, oh, well, we're not trying to erase the canon, we're just trying to renew the canon. When we continue to do that, are we not maintaining the ivory tower of this canon? Are we not saying, well, we shouldn't get rid of it completely, but we can sprinkle in some George Walker and William Grant Still here and there? I believe that we even have to cut that language and say, throw it all away. Put Beethoven on the shelf, put Brahms on the shelf, and let's focus on new things. It's like folks like Norman LeBrecht are empowered and platformed to speak their non-compromising truth, and everyone else believes that some sort of mixed bag, oh, we can have both, is the way forward. That thinking has gotten us here. Mm. That thinking has gotten us where we are right now. I believe, and I've been saying this for a long time, if you put Brahms and Beethoven and all of these overperformed so-called canonical composers, if you put their music on the shelf for 10 seasons, 5 seasons, maybe even 1 season, there wouldn't be a shortage of music. There wouldn't be a shortage of literature for these orchestras to play. We would just be getting rid of a level of respectability politics that I think even some of the most progressive of us don't realize that we're hanging on to. I am unapologetically, at this point, I'm unapologetically on the side of the debate that says, let's not play the canonical composers. And that's not me saying that we're going to throw all of the European composers away, mm-hmm. because shout out to Erlen Wallen, you mm-hmm. know, shout out to Samuel Coleridge Taylor, shout out to all of these women composers and black composers over from over there. But it's not actually going to hurt us or hurt anything to say, let's just cut Beethoven and Brahms and Mozart and Haydn and Debussy and Ravel. Let's just cut them out. Let's just full stop performing them.
Okay. Norman laid out a whole bunch of stuff that is not fact, it is opinion. So I will lay out opinion as well. I agree with Jesse. If you have people that want to be electrified by music in your audience, if you want people who want that sort of communal experience like she was talking about in this interview, then I think you would be far better served to put in something new rather than playing the Invisible City of Kertész suite,
right,
or something. Because tell me the last time you went to an orchestra performance where every single thing on the program was an absolute banger that you loved.
Never. Never.
Okay, now I see some that are getting close to it now.
Well, let me edit that statement. Not an orchestral show. You know, over the weekend, I went and saw Third Coast Percussion. Mm-hmm. Shout out to them. And they actually started their show with a piece by Philip Glass, an arrangement of Metamorphosis. And I was engaged that whole time. Now, of course, there were other aspects, include, you know, there was the big thing was dance. They had two dancers that were interpreting the music live in the moment, which I think is another conversation, how sitting down and just looking at an orchestra or looking at an ensemble play, especially that kind of music, that might also be a thing of the past. I don't know. I feel like you think that I'm trying to egg you on or get you to say something, but I really do see it as an issue of completely wiping out the respectability that has always existed in this art form. Saying things like we don't have to completely get rid of the canon is an acknowledgement of Norman LeBrecht's point in saying that we can't move this music. We can't move this tradition. I'm here to say we can. We just won't.
I got you. And the only thing that I can come back with on the radio perspective is there's a lot of people that have the potential to tune in and hear something, right?
Right.
And some of those people are going to be people of color, and they are going to like Beethoven and Brahms.
Yeah, of course.
And as a public broadcaster, that's what they do, is try to play stuff for everybody. Now, I understand your perspective is that it's white Europeans. I get that. That's why I'm saying not all of it goes. Let's just have the heady mix. Let's just have the mixture. That's what I like in my radio.
And I don't want, you know, some sort of narrative to get out there that is, look, I'm not saying throw away white composers. I don't draw the line there, because anyone who has followed my work over the years, especially in radio production, you'll see women composers all throughout my stuff. Mm-hmm. You will see composers and aesthetics that aren't Western at all. You know, something that a lot of these folks don't do. Mm-hmm. You know, we were talking about Silk Road and them the other week. You know, so it's composers with different abilities. You know, that is important to highlight. Of course, I'm gonna, you know, ride for the black composers as a black man, but sure. I don't know. The point is, there are so many people who don't have to hold their nose or compromise when they make certain opinions or do certain things. I hate to turn it to politics, but there were far fewer people holding their nose to vote for Donald Trump than there were people holding their nose to vote for Joe Biden. You know, there's one side of the fence that is always going to feel like, oh, well, it's about compromise. And then there's the other side who says what they want and puts it all out there. And that, you know, overrides other right. thing or maintains a status quo. That's what I feel like we're dealing with in the arts. And, you know, as we see more organizations like the Black Orchestral Network, you know, as the Black Opera Alliance continues to push all of these, I feel like I have to shout everybody out, arts administrators of color, everybody, all these organizations that are doing the good work, we have to amp up the game. And I'm just sorry. It's time. It is time to say there is enough music out here, enough music that fits the needs and the sensibilities of many people, that we aren't playing, that we aren't platforming, because we feel like Beethoven, Brahms, Gershwin, Copeland, you know, these folks, we feel like they have to be there. Well, look, they don't. I'm also in this moment thinking about all of the comments under some of the ads and posts that Trilloquy, shout out to Jenna, who does the social media. You know, we did we partnered last week with the Peabody Conservatory on some digital promo. I mean, you'd have thought I cussed out somebody's mama in those social media posts when all I did was copy, and I'm ranting right now, but all I did was copy and paste the language that the Peabody Conservatory gave me to announce and to promote their EDI event thing. Mm-hmm. You know, you'd have really thought I'd have cut somebody's mama out the way people are saying, oh, all these identity politics, oh, get this shit out of here, X, Y. You know, so the Norman LeBrecht and all those people, they have their army. mm-hmm. and they have their people. It's time for people who oppose that to step up our game and not try to straddle this fence. And I know that's the uncomfortable conversation, especially when we start to talk about marginalized musicians, you know, black orchestral musicians, black opera singers going and running to these traditional institutions to play this white music for those predominantly white audiences. That's another part of the conversation. But I feel like if anybody is going to be out here painting this wall full of pastels, deep red or deep black, mm-hmm. in the way that I want to, that's what I have to do. And my opinion is we have to completely dismantle the idea that we need these composers in the space at all, because there is enough music, there's enough literature, and there are enough audiences who would really benefit from that music. Okay, that's what I got, y'all. So go read the full article and send me all of your hate mail, because that seems to come through one way or another. I'm gonna play some more Philip Glass to get us into the second movement to highlight the point once again. Racial equity is a part of the work of renewing spaces. Gender equity is a part of renewing work. And class solidarity and capitalism, as much as we're not talking about it yet in art spaces, that is a part of renewing the spaces when we talk about ticket costs and all of these things. So with that being said, I'm here for Philip Glass. He's not a black composer. He's not a woman composer, but he's a composer whose music has been marginalized and can be put in the place of the Beethoven symphonies.
And for the goodness, Invisible City of
Kurtage. For goodness sake, you know, every time I went into a rehearsal as a bassoonist and had to play a Schubert symphony of all things, I'm like, there is something else. There is something else in the world to play. Okay. Anyway, here's a little bit of the final movement of Philip Glass's Violin Concerto Number 2, a subtitled The American Four Seasons. I chose this recording. Norma LeBrecht mentioned Marin Alsop's name. So I want to shout out, you know, my women composers, women conductors here as well. Violin soloist is Robert McDuffie. The ensemble is the London Philharmonic. The finale here to Philip Glass's Violin Concerto Number 2. I feel like I shouldn't project and not offer any bit of context. So let me say this before we start talking about some music for the second movement. The more my name gets out there, the more people see me, the more I am more of a public figure in the change-making spaces, the more intense the so-called feedback gets. Mm-hmm. I'm putting feedback in air quotes. Mm-hmm. There's this idea, and people quoting, like I had a couple of my friends say that, you know, they heard me quoted on other podcasts and other shows saying, you know, to make the point of how ridiculous all of these things are. And the real racists are people like Garrett McQueen on the, you know, anyway.
Who said that?
It doesn't matter. The point that I was trying to make earlier, you know, as we transition with the Philip Glass, is that even if the race and gender issue was dealt with when it comes to the classical spaces as they exist now, if every concert was William Grant Steele, Chevalier de Saint-Georges, Florence Price, Samuel Coleridge Taylor, Margaret Bonds, Jesse Montgomery, we can go on and on. There would still be room to highlight music that was written today or music written, you know, in this era, composers who are alive today. There are so many different directions where we can point renewing these spaces. So when we have folks like Norman LeBrecht going straight to the racial aspect of the conversation in his critique of renewing spaces, I think that says it all right there. He didn't go on there. He didn't write that article shitting on any living white composer or mm-hmm. any of these women composers. He was pointed specifically at black folks. And that's the honest conversation that we need to have about how we're programming and how we're addressing this conversation. So as I move forward, I'm trying to make the point in a way where I feel like more people will understand the larger point being there is music that is just not being platformed, including music by white men composers. Now they're alive and they have aesthetics that haven't always been welcome into the space, you know, so that's, you know, we can have a conversation about that. But all I'm saying is renewal of so-called classical spaces is a multifaceted conversation. I lean in on the racial part of it because that conversation, the conversation of race, impacts my life in more ways than music. So I can bring different perspectives and different ideas into the space as it applies to Black music. But that doesn't mean that there isn't change making work happening everywhere and musicians who aren't Black that also have been sidelined and deserve the space. Am I making sense? Do you hear what I'm saying?
Yeah, I follow you.
Okay.
Yeah. It's cool, man. Relax. Relax. It's peaceful here.
Not you calming me down.
This is safe space.
Okay. We're here in the safe space of the second movement, where me and Scott are going to highlight some music that we have been spending some time with in our own lives. Get us started while I catch my breath, because goodness gracious.
Sure. You remember Inez Guanches?
Yeah, shout out to Inez.
She was in Opus 20.
TRILLOQUY Live, right?
Yeah, with the... played music and also did an interview. And, you know, she and I were working, the two of us were working on some projects for Cinco de Mayo.
Okay. And, which is, yeah, tomorrow, if you're listening to this on Wednesday.
Yeah, I was doing a lot of research on composers from Mexico.
Yeah.
Now, obviously, Alondra de la Parra, she put out a release, and the whole idea was, it was great. It was letting people know that we're more than the hat dance and tacos. That, her words, we're more than this. Because let's face it, you don't hear, you know, like you don't hear a lot of composers from Mexico on the regular.
Right.
And the one that I wanted to bring in, a favorite of mine, is Silvestre Revueltas. Mm-hmm. And his famous one is Song of the Maya, right? That gets played quite a bit. And there's one particular part in it that I think stands out because it's not what you would expect. And not, these days I'm trying to point people in the direction of the things that they would not expect, but like. And during this part, there has to be 10, 12 percussionists all working at their own piece, their own pace, their own beat, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I sit and I listen to it and I think, all right, we're into the second measure and I'm already lost the one.
Say you've lost the one, what you have to understand is that maybe your interpretation of the one doesn't exist in the parameters of this culture.
Valid.
And the music and all of that.
Valid.
But I hear what you're saying.
I just get so enamored with it that mm-hmm. I would forget what my part of it was.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. But you know, and going back to that, the first movement with, you know, remember when music wasn't about a stance or a political or a social agenda or something. Revueltas was in with Chavez, led his orchestra for a while, writes a piece of music that Chavez didn't like. And Revueltas was like, all right, well, see, I'm not going to lead your orchestra
right,
no more.
Right, right.
Mm-hmm. Remember all the way back when it was nice?
and this is what I'm talking about, you know. Silvestre Revueltas is a composer that, I hate saying this sentence, but a composer that most folks don't know.
Mm-hmm.
He's a composer that I have always gone to, and I need to do better, you know, but who I've always gone to when it comes time for Cinco de Mayo, especially. But, you know, this piece that you're talking about, La Noche de los Mayas, anytime that I would want to shift the conversation to indigenous peoples, you know, I would go to this piece. Or as you're talking about, all of my shows in Knoxville were themed. So if I would have a percussion themed show. This is a piece of music that would for sure make the cut. The Knoxville Symphony actually performed this years ago when I was down there. So it's great to have the radio sort of listening perspective on this piece, but also the rehearsal sort of perspective. You know, you're talking about you lost the one. I'm not going to call nobody out, but there was a lot of going back to rehearse, you know, certain percussion
if that's sections. What it takes, and that's what it takes.
But it's a really an incredible piece of music.
I love it.
And anything else to say about La Noche de los Mayas?
You'll notice that I didn't point you to the famous part, you know, the easy part to highlight, you know, in either the first or the finale. I took you to the part I thought you would like. And that's what I'm trying to do recently.
And that's what's so great about some of these pieces of music, that the real meat, you know, you have to be there for and to hear it in context and how it happens, not at the beginning or skipping to the end. Really, really great stuff. If you don't know Silvestre Revueltas, go check out some of his other music. But I would say La Noche de los Mayas is the most famous one. That's the one that comes to mind for me whenever I hear his name. So, yeah, shout out to that composer. It's very interesting, Scott. The way that our musical picks, you know, I bet you there are people who think that we fabricate, but literally you come over here and I'm like, all right, what music you got? And I'm like, oh, well, this is the music that I got. Anyway, the piece of music that I want to talk about is a movement from Vignettes for Oboe, Bassoon, and Piano by William Grant Still. The movement is called Inca Melody. So you had a piece of music that shines on the Mayas. I have one that shines on Inca Melody. So, but before I talk about the piece of music, I just wanted to, offer some context. So, again, I mentioned that with the Lakeville Area Arts, you know, I'm going to be playing this tune and one by Samuel Coleridge Taylor with them. So I went to rehearsal last week, you know, my first chamber rehearsal in years. I've done some orchestral stuff and, of course, the some solo stuff, but my first time just being in that sort of space in a long time. And really, I forgot how intimate it was, you know, playing music of I forget his name right now, one of the former music directors of the Memphis Symphony Orchestra. He did a master class with the U of M Orchestra down there. And I always remember, he said, the second most intimate thing that two people can do together is make music. And I was feeling that in the rehearsal space, when you have to make that eye contact or really tap into what a musician is doing or the way they're breathing so that you can be with them or enter on time. That's really an intimate thing. Something else that was coming to my mind as I was rehearsing was taking that music off the page. Something that my teacher Judy used to hate that I do. The ends of phrases, I would always make them a little longer so that I can get the perfect fadeaway on the notes. And she would be like, well, it's a quarter note. It's not a half note, you know? But anyway, I don't have a teacher now. I'm grown. So shout out to Judy. So, you know, I had to, you know, remind myself during the rehearsal that I can interpret this music the way I want to interpret it. And especially considering, you know, some of the reasons that went into my being invited to do this concert, you know, considering Black composers on the program, the work that I do, you know, I happen to also be a bassoonist. So, you know, I have to take even greater responsibility to do what I can to make sure that this music is coming alive in the way that I think it should be, even if some of the things that I'm playing aren't exactly on the page, the measure not being the ink, but the measure being the legacy that I want people to understand and how I can, you know, make this music come alive. Anyway, the Vignettes span all sorts of feelings. The last movement is like a juba banjo sort of sounding thing. There's a really sweet ode to grandfather. That's a extended bassoon solo that I can't wait to play. But this movement titled Inca Melody has really been on my spirit, and I've returned to it a lot. I want to listen to a little bit of the opening here first. I really go on some journeys with this music. And it, you know, it brings me back to something else that my friends would always say. They were like, oh, Gary, you're thinking too much about this music. But when I hear that opening piano solo, Scott, I'm hearing an ode to a people that we can only read about in books, that we can only see movie depictions of. You know, there are no Inca people left, thanks to colonization and disease and many other things, for us to learn from and experience things from. You know, imagine the music that must have been going on, in those civilizations. So I hear that in that opening piano solo. And then the more it's repeated, the more it starts to sound like a spiritual, like a Negro spiritual, almost as if William Grant Still is saying, these people are gone. We can't hear from them anymore. Is that what y'all want to happen to us as well? I hear that. And I think about those things, and it helps me just juice that music with all of my emotion, because that may not be exactly what William Grant Still had in mind when he was writing those notes, but it's what has survived and made it to my ears and to my sensibilities. And I think these are just small examples of the Venn diagram of culture and conversations that we can have once we normalize so much more of this music. And then toward the end of that movement, you know, the bassoon and the oboe are doubling the piano, and it offers something that has been taking my breath away all week. Yeah, it's like William Grant Still saying, yeah, these ancient Incan people who I can only imagine about and write this music that I can think about maybe sounds like what they have done. They didn't make it. You know, they struggled and didn't make it. Here we are struggling. I hope we make it. I hear all of that when I listen to this music. So when we talk about diversifying on all levels, not only do we need the music, we need the people who can offer perspectives on the music that help people think about things in a different way. We need the performers who can take those ideas and thoughts and infuse them into their approach to the performances. There's so much. You know, the pianist I'm working with, she said that she had never heard of William Grant Still. And you can't be mad at her, because what the orchestra's playing, you know, what's on the radios. And William Grant Still, as we were saying in the opening of this, is not a name that we don't say,
right?
You know, it's a name that we say a lot, but yet it's still not enough, it seems like, because gems of music like this are just, you know, swept under the rug, you know, diamonds that are hidden under all of the dirt of the repeated Beethoven and Brahms and all of that sort of thing. So anyway, go check out the vignettes for oboe, bassoon, and piano by William Grant Still. And again, if you're here in the Minnesota area on Sunday, come on down to Lakeville and hear our take on it. All right, we're getting into the third movement
here.
That face. This week's guest is Christina Salerno. She is the executive director of the Illinois Philharmonic Orchestra. Scott, she was actually named Executive Director of the Year. So, you know,
wow.
A woman who's out here doing some really incredible and unique and impactful work in the orchestral sphere. She began her career in dance. So in our interview, in our conversation, I asked her a couple questions about being a ballet dancer, because I don't talk to ballet dancers all that often. I think right. It's kind of a cool thing. So she talks about how it's a limited career length, which, you know, in part inspired her shift into arts at Men and the many great things that she's doing with the Illinois Philharmonic Orchestra. Where we start, again, we're talking about unique issues in ballet. I believe she mentions, you know, how height can be used against you no matter what your height is, because some places are looking for shorter people. Some places are looking for taller people. And, you know, we go into all sorts of stuff that's happening up there at the Illinois Philharmonic. We're going to transition into the conversation with a little music from Star Wars. You know, this comes out on May the 4th. So, you know, Scott, you, I'm sure you can imagine, especially if May the 4th were a Friday, you know, mixing music for Cinco de Mayo with Star Wars music. Oh, those were the fun programming days. So getting into the Chavez and the Revueltas and, yeah, you know, those composers alongside the, you know, the Star Wars themes that we know and love. Do you have a favorite Star Wars cut from the core films? You know, we can talk about Mandalorian,
Leia's theme.
That's the beautiful one for you.
Yeah.
Okay.
But and all of the marches, I think, are pretty sinister. And then there's Duel of the Fates.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which is sort of a future past version of Carmina Burana, really.
Yeah. And it fits because Star Wars actually comes up in our conversation when we talk about pops programming. Uh-huh. It's easy to go to the movie music and easy to go to the specifically the Star Wars music. So one of the things that Christina Salerno talks about is going even beyond that, you know, and having a pops concert that would really be pops for more people, maybe even younger audiences. But with all that said, you can't sleep on what John Williams has done over the years. Mm. You mentioned how the marches, most of them seem sinister. My favorite track from all of the films is a march, and it doesn't sound so sinister to me. It sounds like the community of extraterrestrial, at least extraterrestrial, the Earth, who made the victory in episode 6 possible. We don't put enough respect on the Ewoks, but I'm gonna put some respect on the Ewoks here. So here's March of the Ewoks by John Williams to get us into my conversation with Christina Salerno, Executive Director of the Illinois Philharmonic Orchestra.
Well, anything that could be a physical attribute can be a barrier or a positive in the dance world because it's such a visual art form. Mm-hmm. A lot of things have changed. I mean, when I was kind of going through the ranks, there were specific companies that were known for being on the shorter side, and I auditioned for them because I am on the shorter side. There were some companies that I would call and they would say right off the bat, how tall are you? And when I'd give my height, they'd say, oh no, we're not interested at all. We only have dancers of a higher, you know, height. But then there's also like the window is really small. So I had some friends that, you know, were like above where those tall companies wanted them to be, and they would struggle to find somewhere to go. Some of them ended up in Europe where they have companies of a little bit different composition sometimes. And I had a colleague that was like 6'1", a female that was a beautiful dancer. The thing is, if you kind of fit outside any parameter, you tended to be someone that was more like a soloist type dancing on yourself. Because if you think about like the big Swan Lakes or Giselles, when you see, you know, 30 to 40 dancers on stage, they tend to be approximately the same height, approximately the same size, because that gives an illusion of multiples. And when you're trying to create that, like that has been necessary. I will say though, that that's changing a lot now because, you know, if you think about certain heights, certain look, certain body size, that also means like a certain type of person. And, you know, as the world is becoming more inclusive, I think a lot of dancers of my generation have really been trying to break down a lot of those barriers and say, like, does it really matter if someone's taller? Does it really matter if, you know, whatever attribute is visible is different than the other people on the stage? No, it probably doesn't matter. And maybe the overall aesthetic is definitely not compromised and possibly is even enhanced by seeing some difference on stage. So that is something that the dance world is definitely grappling with.
Yeah.
And is shifting. And I'm happy to see that shift.
So as things like DEI take hold across the arts and, you know, in the dance world, folks are talking about some of the things that you've laid out. I wonder how much of that conversation has also shifted the way classical dance has been conceptualized in proximation to European traditions and styles of body movement. Are we, from your perspective, is the dance world embracing more of the world of dance in conjunction with these conversations?
Well, yes and no. This is probably the case across the world. I mean, I think the dance world wants to embrace more of that. You know, classical ballet has a very Eurocentric origin story, and that's how everything kind of came down. There have always been other influences, some of which now are not considered, you know, are considered cultural appropriation. Mm-hmm. But at the time were really an opportunity for people of a certain culture to get to experience another culture, because you didn't have, you know, the books necessarily coming through. It would come through on a stage with some sort of, you know, exotic or new element. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that history and that way of bringing forward is definitely being challenged now. There's lots of people who are doing reinvented, you know, stories of the classical ballet stories to like bring them to modern times. And this isn't something that just started now. I mean, this has been going on for decades, but I think now there's a lot more open conversation about it. Where before, you know, if a dance theater of Harlem did a Giselle and a Bayou, which they did many decades ago, mm-hmm. that was like revolutionary and wow, but it was also only something that Dance Theater of Harlem would do. Now, a lot more of the companies are trying to bridge a lot more of those chasms that, you know, kind of exist in our culture and in society. But it's not a straight line, and I wouldn't say it's super easy. You know, people, as you know, in classical music still hold very fondly many traditions.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and that exists in every walk of life and in every art form, and definitely exists in dance as well.
Yeah. So despite that unstraight line, as you've said, you know, the difficulties and the barriers, you made it. So, you know, there you were living the dream as a dancer, and you decided to go sit at a desk. What triggered that shift for you?
Yeah. Well, so another difference for dancers is your performance career is always going to be a short performance career. Mm. Although even I will say that is changing a little bit. There's an Italian ballerina, Alexandra Ferri, who's in her 60s now and has made a comeback and is still dancing amazingly. Wow. Beautifully. Yeah. Wow. And we've had some people in the past of dance history that have done that, but like now it's becoming more prevalent. But so, you know, even as a young dancer, you're kind of thinking, what will I do next? What's going to be the next step? And I was somebody, not everybody's like this, but I was somebody that was thinking kind of proactively about what I wanted to do. Mm-hmm. For a while, I wanted to become a chemical engineer, but the science classes and labs just didn't really fit in my dance life. yeah. And so arts administration was something I was just kind of interested in. I watched organizations that I was a part of and see when I thought it was working and when I thought it really wasn't working. I also wanted to be someone that would help lead some of these changes forward. I think a lot of times, like, the arts are just held, and classical ballet for sure is held on such a high pedestal. And like, it really, I mean, it should be kind of fun and enjoyable to everybody, both audience and the people who are working in it. And I think it can be a lot more approachable than it's been seen sometimes in the past. So I kind of wanted to be part of that renaissance of trying to break down those barriers and find new models forward. So how I found myself.
And not only have you been just a part of it, I mean, you've been leading the way and, you know, recently named Executive Director of the Year. You know, congrats on that. That's huge. Are you are you from Illinois originally?
I am. Yeah. Western suburbs of Chicago. So born and raised, I actually did my original training with Salt Creek Ballet. And then performed kind of all over the place, and then was asked to come back to do administration for Salt Creek. And that made sense to come back to Illinois. And yeah, so Chicago is home.
How has that impacted the work that you've done? Do you feel like you're uniquely qualified to handle the arts in an ecosystem in which you learned the arts and grew up in?
Yeah, I definitely think, I mean, you know, anyone can learn these things with time, but I think when you grow up in a place, you do know some of the dynamics of, how different communities operate, what are the dynamics that are important in different communities. I will say I was away from Chicago for 17 years, so a lot of things had shifted and I had to kind of relearn some things and get up to speed. One of the things being an Illinois Philharmonic that's been fascinating to me is I really didn't know the South and Southwestern suburbs at all. And it's just such a vibrant, like, exciting place to be, with a lot of people that care deeply about the arts. So that's been really interesting to know. And you know, you try to make the connections. Of course, you have some, you know, sometimes that's a little bit hard because there's some people that remember you from when you were 13 and are, you know, still talking to you as if you're 13, which has its benefits and its difficulties. But you know, you kind of go through that and make your connections as you can.
Yeah, you mentioned so many things shifting and changing. And, you know, from my perspective, the way that people approach the idea of programming really has drastically changed. Some of the things that you have planned for IPO next season are incredible, with world premieres, but you also, you know, slip in some of the old war horses, as it were, into the programming. What's your view or perspective on balancing the canon, as it were, with new music and music that might engage new audiences in new ways?
So that is an evolving story, I think, every day. It's something we, you know, have a lot of internal conversations with on our board level and with my music director, who's the primary programmer, and musicians and audiences. So it's always evolving. But you know, I think about the war horses, and you know, the reason why they're war horses is because, number one, they're great music. Quite often. But number two, they've been visible for a very long time. And people have, in my case with orchestras, heard them. So, you know, I think about a piece of music that I hated the first time I heard it was Prokofiev's Cinderella. I found it really dissonant. I was like, I couldn't hear the phrasing in it. It was just really difficult for me.
I think that was the case for the original dancers too, if I'm remembering my music history correctly.
Totally. Very revolutionary its time, right? Yeah. And it seems, so accessible now. But I tell you, after being cast in that ballet and having to listen to it, you know, 30, 40, 50 times through rehearsal and then performances, it's one of my favorite scores now. Like, I just love that music and I hear new things in it every single time. But if I hadn't been kind of forced to listen to that, I wouldn't have liked it. And I think a lot of those war horses, you know, the Beethovens, the Brahms, the Bach, you know, the Mozart, people have heard it. Like, it's in some commercials here and there. You remember it from your childhood, you know, like, it comes up. And so there's nostalgia there and it's comfort. And because it's great music, you can hear something new in it each time. So getting back to your question about programming, I think, one of our main efforts here at Illinois Philharmonic is to try to bring some new music forward that has just as many amazing qualities. But if you're not, given the opportunity to listen to it, you might not have searched it out on your own. And if you can start listening to some new things, you will start really gravitating towards those things and start seeking them out on your own. And then hopefully those will become the war horses of the future, right? Like all music starts as new at some point. It's a balance. We have decided not to go completely the new music route, just because a lot of audiences love what came before. And also, you know, what came before is music is always a stepping stone. People are always learning from it, riffing off it, taking something from it. And so I do think it's important to know our history of where these things came from. And you know, sometimes, you know, that's in program notes giving the real story as opposed to just, you know, a one-sided story, like right. there's good and bad with these human beings that made this music, and also, you know, the time at which it was made. And so maybe we can actually open conversations about that instead of, you know, kind of painting one picture or the other.
Yeah.
It's, you know, honestly, the most challenging thing, though, is to get audiences to accept things, I think, because, you know, it's kind of easy for myself and my music director to say, oh, we love this new stuff. Let's just program it. We can kind of get our board of directors behind it, you know, with a few conversations. But when you have thousands of audience members who are paying just through their, you know, wallets of whether or not they like something, it's sometimes harder to get somebody to take a chance on something.
Sure.
And I'm really pleased to say that, like, the approach we've been taking seems to be working, and I'm getting a lot of really positive comments about, like, oh, I didn't know about William Grant Still. I'm so glad now I've heard a second piece by him. Do you know I'm going to go see, you know, his work be performed somewhere else, or, you know, that's good.
Yeah, and I'm sure folks feel really affirmed when maybe they hear IPO perform Florence Price for the first time in their lives, and they see her name somewhere else, and they're like, "Oh, my orchestra is doing that sort of thing." Yeah, and in my years in radio, I've learned how to contextualize certain aesthetics for audiences in that medium to sort of, you know, prepare them for what they're going to hear, or, you know, get them into the zone. What does contextualizing these new sounds for your audience look like? Is it pre-concert talks? Is it a newsletter warning them that it's going to be different when they come back? What does that look like?
Yeah, I think all of the above. We do pre-concert talks, and sometimes we do post-concert talk backs.
Okay.
Because I find sometimes, you know, after you've listened to something, then you might have better questions about what you just heard. Mm-hmm. So we kind of try to change it up. It's not the same format all the time. On our social media platforms, we try to, like, give little clips about something, maybe a different orchestra performing one of the works, so that people kind of know what they're going to be hearing, you know, in the future. Sometimes some historical things. We have some big screens on the side of our stage, and we have something called Note This, where we have, you know, they're really sound bites, but it'll say different things about the composer and where and when he or she was when they composed it. And did you know that this music was also included in, you know, such and such movie or something? And it would be like, mm-hmm. Oh, but that's not a John Williams. I didn't even know other people composed classical music for movies, which clearly there's lots of people that do that, right?
Oh yeah.
So, you know, I think any way you can get it to people, I really do believe that people are so inundated with information now that, you know, not going with just one format of trying to reach somebody is important, because, you know, usually it's not the one email they notice, but it's like that, like you say, they're in another town and they say, oh, Florence Price is playing here in New York. I got a chance to see, mm-hmm. see that. I didn't even know that was a big deal when I did. Right. So you just keep talking about it as much as you can.
You mentioned Prokofiev earlier, and there's actually a Prokofiev piano concerto coming up for IPO's season closer. When I think about context, I think about not only personal context, but context in the world. Of course, you know, we're still witnessing everything that's going on in Ukraine. What do you have to say about context in that regard, thinking about a Russian composer like Prokofiev in light of what Russia is doing to Ukrainians and in essence to the world? Is it worth going there for your audiences, or do you take more of the let's keep that separate approach?
Yeah. So again, it's always a conversation that was programmed prior to Russia invading Ukraine.
Right.
You know, obviously the situation in Ukraine is deplorable and horrible on so many levels. I have a lot of friends that are Ukrainian. I have a lot of friends that are Russian, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like this is a hard time for a lot of people. And So as it goes to the programming, you know, right away, my music director, Stillian Kirov, and I kind of like had a conversation, like, are we keeping this in the program? Should we change it? You know, I should mention he's Bulgarian. He's married to a Russian woman. They're both American citizens. You know, like, you know, the world is so interconnected now that this is all really difficult. I think one of the things that's easy and clear in this standpoint is that Russia should not be doing what it's doing. And,
right.
and luckily we live in a place with information that I think we can all agree on that. But as it comes to programming, you know, I think we look at the intent of the work and the individual, you know, the composer in this case. And I know, like, you know, there are some cases in which organizations have felt that, you know, they had somebody that was contemporary now that is a direct friend or contact of Putin's. And so, you know, it's probably appropriate. And we would make that call as well to not program that now. You know, Prokofiev is an interesting example, though, because, you know, 100 years old, the music is something like that. You know, Prokofiev himself lived in Europe for a lot of times. You know, a lot of scholarship says that, you know, he left during the Russian Revolution and then kind of came back during Soviet times. But a lot of choices that he made were more about self-preservation. So, you know, clearly didn't stand for one regime. And clearly that's not the same regime that is there now. And so for us, I think now it's an opportunity to showcase some fantastic, great music and to open the conversation with people about, like, why is this a good idea? Or why would you have preferred, you know, that we not program it? And let's talk, because again, nothing is really black and white. Or very few things. There are some things, but very few things. And so, you know, like, we also don't want to get in the habit of, and I don't like the cancel culture nomenclature, but, you know, like, just canceling something just because it's associated with something else. You know, you hear the stories with the start of the pandemic about Chinese restaurants that were suffering because people wouldn't go to Chinese restaurants. Like, that is just not where I think this world should be. And I don't think it benefits anybody. Clearly, direct perpetrators, you know, need to be held accountable, and we need to have open conversation. So if performing Prokofiev helps us all have conversation, then I think that that's actually a good thing and not a bad thing.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, and for what it's worth, I noticed a lot of orchestras were running to the music of Shostakovich because of his reputation for standing up against oppressive regimes. But I think Prokofiev is even more appropriate considering, you know, some of the stories we have about him that live in the shadow of Shostakovich. So, you know, I'm hoping for a great performance of that piece. You know, it's always music. It's for me, it's music that's prickly enough to sound new to a lot of people, but at the same time, within the box enough to be engageable. And as you were saying, maybe even inspire some conversation outside of it.
Yeah.
So we can talk about arts things, you know, all day, but a big part of your job is away from the stage and away from the music. I find it really notable the amount of money that you've been able to raise for the arts. You know, it's something that a lot of artists either don't have the experience with or don't have the desire to really engage, having those conversations to get those big donations and to maintain those big donors. What do you attribute your success to in that regard? Is this something that you learn in arts administration school as a dancer? Are you good at selling yourself and that's bled over? What does that look like?
Well, I think first and foremost, you can only really be successful in fundraising on the long term if your product is really good. I think on the short term, you know, people are really good salespeople and kind of take that approach sometimes. But I think when something's really long-standing, it's because the actual art product is really good. And so I'm really, you know, proud of the artistic product that we have here at Illinois Philharmonic. And that kind of makes my job pretty easy.
Okay.
It's just about starting conversations. I also really come from the premise that everybody can give to art. Everybody has capacity to give. Of course, everybody has different capacity. But if something is meaningful to them and they want to see it flourish, then they will find a way to support it if you give them an opportunity and a way to do so. So really, it's just starting conversations with people and also being open to say, you know, your donation matters at the $20 level. Your donation matters just as much to me as someone who's given us $200,000. Like, it is important and it's valid. If $20 means a lot to you, then it means a lot to us. And I think fundraising at its core really should be about that everywhere, because, you know, we all live in this world, and if we all want to see the world be a more vibrant place, we have to kind of support what's meaningful. I also think sometimes, you know, a lot of people give to the arts because they want it to be meaningful or accessible to people other than themselves. And I think that's, like, you know, such a selfless thing to do. Arts donors, yes, they're doing it for them in some ways, but they don't get to pick the programming or, you know, like, you know, they're doing it so that musicians get paid, because we really believe strongly in compensating musicians and artists for their work. I'd always love to do more of that. Of course, there's always, you know, some, you know, barriers to doing everything the way we would like to do it. But, you know, it's important. And if you want to see music and you want kids to grow up with music, then they have to be surrounded with music. And then, hey, what do you think about helping us do that? And I think if you give people that choice, most people will choose to support. And I think that's really where we've been successful.
Yeah, I want to touch on that accessibility piece. So you have donors who have that in mind, making sure that this music, this product is accessible to more people. How does IPO execute that? What does creating accessibility look like from where you sit?
Yeah, so one of the things I'm really proud of is our Checkout IPO program. So we actually have partnership with 34 area libraries, and any resident of those libraries, communities, can go to their library and check out a pass to come see our concert. I forget exactly how many, but you don't just get one ticket. You get a ticket for yourself and I believe your family at this point. And so we get a lot of people coming in through that Checkout IPO program. You know, it's interesting. When we first started it, there was, of course, like a lot of concern about, well, you know, people should be buying tickets. And I do believe people should support things that are important to them in every case. And are there some people, you know, taking advantage of it? Yeah, maybe a little bit, but really not, because in general, people who it's meaningful for will buy a ticket. They might come once and then they'll decide, oh no, I really enjoyed that, I'll come again. But you know, it's for the people who aren't sure whether classical music is right for them, or maybe, you know, aren't ready to make that investment or can't buy that many tickets for their family. Or to be honest, love their library and support their library. And so, you know, this is a benefit of supporting their library. And so we get a lot of people every single concert to come through that Checkout IPO program. And I think that's one of the best ways that we've been accessible. We also try to do a number of free concerts, smaller chamber groups usually, over the summer times, that we try to, you know, have free admission for. We do a lot. We just started a new Maryland Tannenbaum Youth Music Education Institute. And so all of our education programming kind of goes under that. And some of it's fee for service. Of course, we have to, you know, make our bottom line, but a lot of it is heavily subsidized and or free. So, you know, going into school districts and sending musicians, and the school district might pay a nominal amount or nothing at all. So that's another way that we just try to get out there and provide as much to the community as we possibly can.
How dedicated to things like POPS programming is the Illinois Philharmonic. We can talk a lot about exposing, you know, new audiences to music that's new to them. I also feel like it's important to meet people where they are as often as we can. Does the IPO engage jazz or, you know, oldies or what are those programs?
Yeah, so right now we've been integrating those kind of works into our regular concert season.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, so, you know, we might have, like last year for one of our virtual programs, we did Duke Ellington's Nutcracker as opposed to the classical Nutcracker, right? Still Nutcracker, I know. Oops, excuse me. So sometimes we're doing that. You know, Pops, you're a classical musician, so you know, like, I've coming from dance, I had to kind of get around this idea of like what an audience member of a certain generation considers pops is different than what I would consider pops. Like right. I consider more, you know, like the Star Wars movies or, you know, some anime screen, you know, things, more popular music, than, you know, say sans Dance Macabre or, you know, Tchaikovsky's overture, you know. So that has been a little learning curve. We've been trying to expand more into like, you know, ideally right before COVID, we were having serious conversations about doing like a 3-concert, you know, series of more popular music so that people would kind of see things from that venue. Of course, COVID kind of put that on the hiatus a little bit. But I tell you where we've really had success with those kinds of things are for our chamber music and especially outdoor concerts. Like last year we had a whole concert that was string quartet music, but it was all popular music. So they did Queen's Bohemian Rhapsody. They did, something from, The Weeknd, you know, there was some Beyonce, like, and so, you know, people are there and they're like, what do you mean? Like, oh, that's Beyonce you're playing just with stringed instruments. Like that's kind of fun, you know? And, so it can be easily accessible that way. I just heard a great string quartet version of, Led Zeppelin's, Cashmere, which is like beautiful, amazing. Right. And that's a little old school now for, you know, some today's audiences, but if you can throw in some Rihanna and some Weeknd, you know, then you're hitting people where they are.
Yeah, yeah. I think I'm going to find that string quartet. Before I throw a final question at you, how can folks learn more about the Illinois Philharmonic Orchestra, support, buy tickets, and see what's coming up next season?
Yeah, fantastic. So you can visit our website. We're at ipomusic.org. And also, you know, you can always call us 708-481-7774. Our offices are in Park Forest, Illinois. We perform at Ozinga Chapel, which is on the campus of Trinity Christian College. And really, you know, we're here to serve the south and southwest suburbs of Chicago in any way we can. So would love for people to reach out, support, buy tickets, you know, come see a concert, get involved, or even ask us to come bring some educational programming to your local schools.
Yeah, yeah. Well, so you use the word success, and it's easy for all of us to measure success by the bottom line at the end of the season or at the end of these programmings. What does the money look like? And I understand, you know, how important that is. Of course, you know, have to think about that all the time. But I wonder, you know, for anyone listening who may be engaging arts administration, what are other ways that you measure success than the bottom line? And it has to be more than just the money when we use that word success.
Yeah, I think number one, are people really like enjoying in general the work and the product and the experience? And I mean, clearly every day is not going to be a party, but you know, like in the end, we're in this work to make art and to give people a chance to kind of get out of their everyday lives. And so if you feel like in general, it's kind of fun and invigorating and you like what you're doing or seeing, then I think that's one great measure of success. I also think pre-COVID, there was really, a preponderance of judging success by numbers. You know, grant makers are always asking for like, how many people are coming, and like, you know, each year on year, you want to see increased ticket sales, and you want to see increased audiences, and like, clearly audience development is important. We need audiences for the products that we have, and we want to engage audiences. But I really think a lot more now in terms of like the quality of the experience. You know, are people coming up to you after a concert and say, wow, that really meant something to me? You know, we have a number of board members and audience members that are people of color. And I've recently had a couple of them come up to me and say, you know, it means so much to me that IPO is performing regularly, works by Florence Price and you know, William Grant Still and others, like not just the names now that have become more visible. And I'm so glad that they are becoming visible. But like, what else is out there? Who else is out there that we haven't done? So I think that's success. And I think success is when people answer your phone calls, you know, like if you're looking to collaborate, if you're looking for money, if you're looking for, you know, vendors for things, if people are happy to work with you, even if they can't work with you now, even if the answer is no right now, but maybe yes for the future, I think that's a great measure of success, because that means like you are a part of the community and hopefully you're making a difference.
I thought I'd take us out with a little ballet music by William Grant Still, an excerpt there from Sahdji. One of my favorite pieces of music to return to. I happen to have that recording on vinyl, but, you know, of course, that's a digital version of it here. Howard Hanson with the Eastman Rochester Symphony Orchestra and chorus. And of course, you know, the Eastman Rochester Symphony Orchestra is historic in its own regard for, you know, all of the historic things that were happening when we talk about the conversation of race. And William Grant Still specifically, his first symphony, William Grant Still's Afro-American Symphony, premiered on the campus of the Eastman School of Music. I've been in that hall where that piece of music was heard for the first time. It's sort of a hallowed place. So, you know, I love returning to that recording. And, you know, again, considering the fact that Christina is a ballet dancer, it was great. Always great to return to some ballet music. Huge shout out and thank you to Christina Salerno for joining me this week. Before we hop into the fourth movement, you know, as much as we've been returning to William Grant Still and this opus, there are still people who may be hearing about him for the first time, still, you know, considering everything we've been talking about in this opus. If you had to introduce someone, as I'm sure you are, you know, unbeknownst to you, but as you introduce more people to William Grant Still and Florence Price specifically, these two Black composers who we feel like we say all the time, but there are a lot of people who don't know, how would you make the introduction? Is there a specific piece of music, or how would you approach that?
How would I do it if I was on the air, or if I'm just trying to get somebody turned on to their music?
Either way.
Well, again, lately I'm not trying to point people in the direction of things that they would expect, but rather things that I think they would like. Mm-hmm. And excuse me, I've had good luck with Miss Sally's Party.
Oh, but the William Grant Still.
Yeah. For some reason, there's maybe it's that there's elements that are almost like show tunes.
So that familiarity, you know, as a jumping off point for people, maybe.
Maybe, yeah. But also we've talked loads and loads about his string quartet, you know, how easy to listen to that is
for
anybody. You know, there's the simplicity and the complexity in the simplicity piece about it. For Florence Price, the Mississippi Suite. You see, I like these programmatic things, I think.
Yeah.
But the Mississippi Suite takes you right from the headwaters down to New Orleans.
Yeah.
And you hear what you might hear on a riverboat going through these different regions. I mean, that's just a clever.
And with that Mississippi River Suite, you know, it's not always a friendly sounding piece of music,
right,
because it
wasn't
always friendly people along that river, was it?
Sure.
Anyway, all right, we're going to get into the fourth movement here with a piece of music that I want you to tell me a little bit more about on the other side of this, but this is how I'll intro it. So in addition to going to see Third Coast Percussion over the weekend, it was Maria Issa's birthday. Shout out to Maria Issa, member of the Trilloquy family. And wherever she goes, she brings music. Mm-hmm. And I'm talking live music.
Nice.
And so at her birthday party, there was this trio, voice, percussion, and guitar. Sounded, there wasn't a program or anything. I wish I knew their names or who they were, but the music that they were playing was very familiar to most people in the room. I didn't know these songs, but they were really incredible. And the one that I loved hearing the most for the first time for me was this one. We'll listen to a bit of it to get into the fourth movement here.
Para Marcané, llego a Puerto, voy para Mayarín. De Ando Cero, voy para
And Maria's party. It was the man playing guitar singing with the woman mm-hmm. who was the lead vocalist, and she had the shakers. First of all, shout out to shakers because mm-hmm. it's like that little bit of seasoning that you don't always think about, but when you have it, you're so grateful for it. Anyway, so I'm used to hearing a woman's voice in there, but just such a beautiful song and the way those harmonies work. You had to tell me whether I took a video on my phone and you were like, oh, that's Chan Chan.
Right.
And who's it by?
Well, it's performed by the Buena Vista Social Club.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's a film also titled Buena Vista Social Club, which mm-hmm. was, I think it has won some awards. But for me, that was also just an audio bookmark in a really, really wonderful time in my life. And I hear that and I start to think of company over for some cocktails before a meal.
Yeah.
And then after the meal's over, we push the furniture back and dance or play music and sing like yeah. that. A much more carefree point, much less to worry about.
Yeah. Let me reiterate a point that I was making earlier. I just want to make sure that I was clear. When we talk about renewing spaces, classical spaces, and how some people jump straight to critiquing the racial aspect of the conversation, again, that's where I lean in. I lean in there unapologetically. But as we talk about renewal, there are things like that I believe fully deserve space in on a classical program, on a radio, in a concert hall, chamber music. That's classical music to me. That comes from a tradition that is obviously tied to the foundation of Cuban culture. The ensemble at Maria's birthday party was Cuban, so mm-hmm. I don't know if that piece of music in particular is Cuban, but anyway, you can hear those roots, that the classical aspects of that music. So, you know, there's work being done in all aspects when we talk about renewal. You know, living composers who happen to be white, yes, but living composers, music like that, of course, Black composers, historic and otherwise. It really takes all of us in our own different corners, you know, pushing so that the whole circle gets broader. I just want to make sure that's clear. Sometimes I get on this microphone and feel like folks don't understand what I'm saying, but maybe that's the gaslighting that I deal with.
Damn.
In the inbox.
Damn.
And you know, just like Van Lathan was talking about in the downbeat. Anyway. We're in the Trilloquy, the movement where, you know, we offer something true and real for the week. And this week, Scott, I'm just going to tell a quick story from my week. I had a busy week. Most weeks I'm in here in Studio G, minding my business, doing my work. But sometimes the work makes me go outside. Okay. So long story short, I had to go to the city, the suburb of Edina last week. Quickly, tell the non-Minnesota folks about Edina. I'm only chuckling. That's a rough neighborhood for me.
I want to give a little disclaimer here.
Go for it.
I know people who are from or live in Edina, and they are delightful people.
Yep.
But the stereotype, let me underscore that, the stereotype of Edina is an affluent suburb. Yep. They have a sur la table.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the... things are very kept and manicured and white.
Yeah. Yeah. So when
so
when we start talking about suburbs that look like that and feel like that, and you have a person like me, I'm walking down the street, I got dreads, I'm not wearing a suit or nothing like that. It doesn't look like I'm on my business lunch. Mm. It looks like I'm doing whatever I'm doing. I can't help but to feel the sort of pressure, the eyes on me. You know, when I got to a diner last week, I parked on the street in this little business area, got out my car. And as soon as I got out my car, I stood up and looked over. And there was a woman standing on the sidewalk looking at me, kind of see what I was doing. And as soon as she saw me look at her, she grabbed her child and, you know, just protectively, you know, put that arm around and kept walking. So, you know, that is a real thing. But nonetheless, I decided to, you know, go forward in a former life that in itself would have made me get back in my car and drive away. But anyway, I kept going. The meeting that I had, the address I was given, I get there and it's a salon full of women who look like they have plenty of money and plenty of time to spend plenty of money because this was in the middle of the day. Mm. You know, this was like 2 p.m. I walk in the door of this salon and it was almost, I used to have a record scratch here on the board. It was almost like the record scratched and everyone turned around and looked straight at me. The receptionist desk is not at the front of the place. It's in the middle. So I had to walk through all of these eyes. Oh, what is this young Negro in here doing? Anyway, I go to the desk and say, oh, I'm here to meet such and such. And they're like, Oh yeah, he works downstairs. So anyway, I go downstairs, and we have this incredibly productive meeting. So I'm bringing this up because it reminded me a lot of a story that I like to read from the Buddhist text. There's this guy named Milarepa who comes home to his cave and there are demons all throughout the cave. So he's running around telling them to shoo, get out of here. And that only, you know, livens up the demons. So he's like, okay, fine. Let me read some of the sacred texts. Maybe that will scare y'all away. And then, so he starts reading these sacred texts and that doesn't scare the demons away. I think the writings are they just, instead of running around, they sat there and stared at him with gaping eyes, you know, a lot of the way that I felt stared at in that space. So that didn't work. So he said, you know what? Fine. If you're here to take me, just take me. You know, he just gave it all up and he opened his eyes and most of the demons at that ran away, but there was one who was still there. Well, with that one demon that was left, Milarepa opened the demon's mouth and stuck his own head in the mouth of the demon to say, you're here to take me down? Go ahead, do it. Take me down. I stand firm that this is where I belong. And if this is my fate in this space where I belong, so be it. In doing that, that final demon went away and Milarepa was able to achieve enlightenment and all of those things that the texts talk about. Anyway, all of that to say, when I drove to Edina, it reminded me of the many times I walked into a concert hall or into a space to perform or even enjoy the concert. And people think that I don't belong in that space. But in standing my ground, not running away from the discomfort, but in standing my ground, not only am I able and have I been able to perform great music and enjoy great music over the years, I've been able to bloom my own career and my own sensibilities into something so much greater than I ever would have imagined. That's the message that I want to bring out to folks, especially as we're getting close to the end of season 3 of Trilloquy. Sometimes you're going to have some demons, you know, staring at you. Sometimes you're going to feel like you're in a space where nothing can go wrong or nothing can go right, rather. It might even get to the point where you feel like, you know what, I've lost and I'm just going to let y'all take over, you know, as that story says. But in letting go of that ego and letting go of what we believe is ours and letting go of the way tradition has been embedded in us, I feel like we can get something greater. And that's what we're all trying to do here in our own ways. Yes, here on Trilloquy, we can talk spicy. We can, you know, cuss people out even. But at the end of the day, we love this art form. We love the space that we have landed in, whether it's as performers, as broadcasters, as curators, as administrators, wherever it is, we fell into it and we have developed a relationship with it. So we're trying to change it. I'm keeping my head in the mouth of the proverbial demon by continuing in this work, by continuing to sift through all of the problematic emails and DMs, to look in the face these organizations that feel like they're being progressive and pushing about progress, when at the end of the day, they're only sprinkling in composers here and there and still centering Beethoven and Brahms, you know, just going in these circles that make folks like me feel like I'm going crazy. All of that, I'm keeping my head in the mouth of that demon for the sake of something greater, not just for me and my career, not just for you and not just for Trilloquy, but the entire ecosystem. I can't wait until one day I can hear Chan Chan on the radio and your brilliant break to go along with it, you know, one of your South Florida stories, you know, that you can connect with that. I can't wait until we have folks that are actually standing up against not only folks like Norman Lebrecht, but the folks that platform his messaging and the folks that pay him to continue to do that sort of thing. These are the big steps that I want to see in the arts that I think we can get to, especially considering all of the grassroots work that's happening. Season finale next week. Hope to see y'all there.